and good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to AIU's Serious Talk webinar, where the jobs are in 2014. In today's competitive job market and equally challenged environment, people today are looking for industries that will provide sustainable job opportunities. So during our webinar this afternoon, American Intercontinental University is going to discuss three of the fastest growing industries in 2014, which include healthcare, human resources, and finance. Our panel today are going to share their insights about these industries, the job growth, and how you can break into these expanding industries. I'm Christy Kotek, the Director of Student Success here at AIU, and I'd like to welcome our panel of experts. We have Kate Wolensack, Director of Compensation and Benefits of Morton Salt. We have Vicki Gore, AIU alumni and business analyst for JP Morgan Chase, and senior healthcare executive, psychologist, author, and one of AIU's very own faculty, Dr. Robert Rodriguez. So I'd like you all just to take a moment to introduce yourselves. Kate, can you get us started?
Thank you, Christy, and thank you for having me back at AIU. My name is Kate Wolensack. I am currently the Director of Compensation Benefits, or Total Rewards, for Morton Salt in Chicago. I do have a bachelor's and master's degree in human resources and have spent my entire career in HR, from Fortune 100 companies, Fortune 500 companies, manufacturing, and service industries.
We're glad to have you here today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Christy, and thank you to AIU for the opportunity to talk about healthcare. I've been a healthcare executive for about 35 years, both as a provider, a hospital administrator. I was a senior healthcare planner under President Nixon. Currently, I'm an administrative consultant to 12 hospitals in Central Ohio, along with being, of course, faculty here at AIU. And I've been with AIU since 2005.
Long run.
Enjoyable.
Thank you so much. Vicki?
Hi. Thanks, Christy. My name is Vicki Gore, and I am an AIU alumni twice. I got my bachelor's degree from AIU in business administration and went on to get my MBA in accounting and finance in 2006. I have over 20 years experience in the financial services industry. I'm currently working at JP Morgan Chase. I've held many positions at JP Morgan Chase, and I'm happy to be here. Thanks for having me.
Great. Well, thank you all for the introductions. We're very excited to have you here this afternoon. Before we dive into the questions, I want to get our online audience involved because you all play a really important part of this discussion as well. So throughout the webinar, I'll be asking you a few questions, and if you could just type your answers into the chat box, that would be great. And throughout the discussion, we'll be sharing those answers with all of you. So the first question that I have for our online audience is, if you could just type in and tell us if you are considering a career change, if you're thinking of getting a degree, or if you've just graduated from college. So again, if you could just type those in the chat box, we'd appreciate it, and we'll be sharing those responses in just a few minutes. So let's go ahead and turn back to our panel of experts and talk about job growth. Now, the Bureau of Labor Statistics has projected that a number of industries might be experiencing growth through 2020. So what can students who are going back to school now or graduating soon expect in terms of job growth and opportunities in 2014 for your industries?
I can speak to that. For human resources, obviously we're on a financial upswing, which is good because those who are considering retirement are now having some financial stability and they are leaving their organizations, which creates huge opportunities for growth in jobs, movement in organization through promotions and vacancies. It always provides an opportunity for an organization to relook at their structure. Human resources is vital to making sure that companies are staffed with the right staff and enough staff. And we are going to be very busy in human resources in all fields that we're going to talk about today.
Thank you.
Let me talk about healthcare just for a few minutes. Healthcare, in many respects, has been the recession-proof industry. One has to keep in mind that as an industry, healthcare is the second largest employer in the world, and it's second only to the federal government, and I mean the world. So our industry is larger than you'd find in many, many, many other countries. The growth rate has been at 5% steady through most of the decade, and it's projected to now be moving to 7% and maybe as high as 10%. And that's because of diversification, consolidation. A lot of people don't realize we have over 6,000 hospitals in the United States, and that's hospitals alone. Over 1 million physicians, over 6 million nurses, and on and on. But what we're seeing is diversification. Mm-hmm. So hospitals are opening their own skilled nursing facilities. They're getting into other businesses, and that's where AIU and I think our students come into play.
And I'll build on that. I think that finance is growing for the simple reason that people are working longer. They need help with their retirement. They need to work with financial advisors to figure out when they can retire. I also think that the expansion of healthcare, you need finance people for that. People have to look at cash flows. They have to understand the business and how these businesses can expand. So I think finance is going to grow exponentially in the future.
And healthcare has absolutely touched the HR industry as well, as
no
we
question.
All know, yep. With the Affordable Care Act, with what's going on in the government right now. There is a huge need for benefit specialists, leave of absence specialists. Anyone going through open enrollment right now for benefits could probably use with an extra hand.
Yep. So. And I think the insurance industry is going through a transformation.
Absolutely.
As a result of ACA.
Absolutely.
And so it's a complete reconfiguration. Mm-hmm. For my side in the business of hospitals and healthcare, a lot of it is the question mark. How is reimbursement going to change? Mm-hmm. How is the patient population going to change? Expenditures, staffing, where they diversify, how they grow. Mm-hmm. 97% of the hospitals in America are not-for-profit. Mm-hmm. And yet you see them all building $200 million wings on them.
Exactly.
And you go,
that's
wow,
right.
What's going on here?
Yeah. So. Well, we definitely know these are, you know, with your responses, that there are three industries that are certainly growing. So can you share with us what are some of the fastest growing jobs within those industries?
I would say in finance, probably financial analysts or advisors. You know, as I stated, you know, people who are retiring later, even those who maybe want to retire sooner need to understand how to save for that. So they seek out financial advisors to help them. So I think that's probably one of the areas where we will see a lot of growth. I think auditing is another area that people don't think about, especially with all the regulations and compliance, with the securities industry. There's lots of auditing, especially in financial institutions. That's a big thing now, regulation and compliance. So I think that's going to be an area that we see a lot of growth as well.
And of course, you know, with that, accounting and so forth, all of that is in the hospitals too, and in the clinics, and in the large companies, mm-hmm. the large for-profit companies that are owning large chains of skilled nursing facilities. Now, there's always going to be room for clinical people.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I'm going to push that aside because I think we're going to see a flood of clinical people. And mm-hmm. we're also seeing a change in the hospitals that I work with in which they're looking for more business background to come in rather than promote a clinician mm-hmm. to an administrative job mm-hmm. Because it's an entirely different mindset,
absolutely.
Skill set. And so they're beginning to look for people that can do accounting, people that can set up records, people can manage large record systems, EMRs, mm-hmm. For keeping track of patient records, mm-hmm. IT, big.
I don't think there's any industry that isn't trying to manage costs. And when you're trying to manage costs, you need financial people, but you need actuaries, and you need someone who's especially the cost of healthcare. In the manufacturing and service industries and in the company I work in, that healthcare cost is really important, and we rely on actuaries and financial people to help us look at those costs and how we're going to do more cost sharing with the individuals. So I would say in human resources, definitely in the benefits area, work-life balance, wellness, we have jobs and roles mm-hmm. in that. We can always use with more recruiters. and training and development is huge. Because as you've got a current workforce, you want to train them, develop them, promote them, and move them through your organization and invest in them. Those are all growing areas in human resources.
Great. You said training development is one of the, you know, one of the hot jobs out there. And I think, you know, some individuals that are within training and development feel that their jobs are always going to be the ones that might be cut first. Mm-hmm. Can you speak to that a little bit?
You know, it's in an organization, there's training and development, but you also outsource for training and development. I mean, you want to invest in your employees. So whether they're going to school or taking a class or getting certification, training and development isn't just classroom training anymore. It's beyond that. It's attending webinars. It's attending events like this. Continuous learning will always be important. And so you have to think beyond the traditional company when you're thinking of a training and development role.
Great. Thank you. Mm-hmm. So the results are in from the first question that we asked our audience. So let's go back and share those results really quickly. So we have 50% of our audience here that are considering a job change, 25% are thinking of getting or advancing a degree, and 19% are currently in school or have just graduated. So congratulations to those who are getting really close to graduation. I know that that's certainly an exciting time. And thank you for chiming in and sharing where you're at currently. So let's go back to the panelists and Dr. Rodriguez, some questions specifically for you for healthcare. Healthcare management is getting a lot of publicity currently. What types of healthcare jobs are you really seeing growing?
Well, in almost every sector, almost every area, business area in healthcare, we're seeing expansion. Again, there is a move, and it's actually occurred over these last 10 years, of physicians breaking away from hospitals and setting up their own ambulatory outpatient. You see that with orthopedics. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You see that with cardio, some pulmonary, and so forth. Well, these are large independent businesses. Okay, they're usually set up on a for-profit basis. And that's where I think we're going to see a real need for managers, as well as those that can do strategic planning, the long-term planning, for skilled nursing facilities, for home care. Mm-hmm. Home care is something that mm-hmm. is not only in ACA, but it's been a movement that's been growing. Mm-hmm. Physical therapy centers. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Absolutely.
So there are all these different businesses. I think, you know, a mistake that is sometimes made is we think about the healthcare industry and we think about hospitals. Mm-hmm. And hospitals really, in some ways, are the smallest part of it, because, you know, it extends to benefits, and it extends to insurance, and it extends to claims processing and reimbursement rates. So, I mean, you know, I encourage my students to start thinking of the industry, mm-hmm. not the hospital. Mm-hmm. So
it's short-term care, it's long-term care,
yeah,
it's memory care. It definitely extends beyond the hospital.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Absolutely. So can you also tell us a little bit about what healthcare managers do?
Well, they're, you know, it's across the board. Most of it is leadership, organization, planning are those that I work with. It may be interesting to the audience as well as to the panel here. The average salary on a healthcare manager, not a CEO of a hospital, but someone that's in a leadership position over, say, skilled nursing or home care companies, it's about $98,000 a year. That's an impressive salary.
Absolutely.
CEOs in hospitals are all over the map and they make considerable money. But management, I think, still functions on planning, organizing, evaluating, controlling. We still have the basic functions of management, no matter where we place an individual.
Absolutely. So if hospitals are reducing their personnel, where is the growth potential in healthcare management?
Well, again, we move from hospitals and we start looking at all of those things that connect to the hospital, the home healthcare companies, mm-hmm. The electronics companies, the IT companies, think of all of the things that go into the continuity of care. Okay? So quality health care consists really of four elements: communication, collaboration, coordination, and continuity of care. And in those first three C's, that requires someone that has people skills, that's able to connect offices together. Okay, this isn't a clinical position. This is a management position.
Absolutely. So we talked a lot about the different positions that are out there within healthcare, but what kind of education do you need to become a healthcare manager?
Well, an MBA, I think, is probably starting and minimal. We've moved to a point now of looking for MBAs, particularly MBAs that have taken courses in healthcare management, healthcare information systems, and so forth. Those are strong resume items to put together.
Absolutely. So for those in our audience who want to become a healthcare manager, what would be your recommendation and how they can get started in that field?
Well, you know, I think all of us here on the panel and all of our audience at some point networked for a job. They knew somebody who knew somebody who knew somebody. And it's no different in healthcare. It's a lot about networking. But one thing that's different is healthcare has a lot of organizations. For example, the strongest is the American College for Healthcare Executives, ACHE. And I do a lot of recommendations to them. Because they have breakfast seminars, they have breakfast meetings, conventions, and this is where our graduates, recent graduates, get to meet these individuals mm-hmm. and really present themselves and say, this is, you know, I'm a newly minted degree, mm-hmm. and, you know, what would you suggest to me? This is how you meet people. You've got to broaden the network, and you do it through, I think, associations, organizations, seminars, and functions.
That's great. And networking, of course, is key, like you said, to any industry and someone looking to start a career or change to a different career or making a career change. For someone who doesn't have any experience in healthcare and they're just graduating with their degree, outside of networking, what type of positions or what type of organization would you suggest for them to target?
Well, one thing that's available to all of us, contingent on time, is volunteering into not-for-profits, mm-hmm. because there are a lot of not-for-profits connected to healthcare, mm-hmm. All aspects of healthcare, and they need volunteers, they need people to help, and it's one way that you start to learn the field and learn about the people in the field. Mm-hmm. So that would be my suggestion, is if you have no experience whatsoever, look around your community. Mm-hmm. Look at the Heart Association, look at the Cancer Society, see what you can do there.
Mm-hmm. And for human resources and finance, do you think volunteering is crucial as well or can be beneficial?
Absolutely. And HR is so tied to the healthcare industry. Just speaking from experience at every company I've worked for, we have employee assistance services, EAP as they call them, programs that employees can count on to go for additional legal, financial, or mental health when they have stressors in life. They count on those clinicians to answer the phone 24/7. Wellness initiatives are huge right now. We have medical carriers that come to our site during benefits open enrollment from our different providers, and they too are from the healthcare industry and have an education in healthcare, and they're presenting to our employees. So the cross-pollinization, if you call it, of a healthcare professional in human resources in a company is critical. I could not speak the way they do on benefits. And a lot of our medical carriers today have 24/7 health lines. Either they're online or they're web-based or they're telephone and in telephony. But employees, everybody runs 24/7 now, and so you want those services, especially from the healthcare industry as well.
Thank you.
I think in finance, it's a little bit harder to volunteer. I do know in the banking industry, they do have programs for recent graduates where they intern, and then they get to learn different areas of maybe a bank. There are areas where they can learn more about becoming an underwriter and those type of things. So I would encourage students to, you know, if you're looking in the financial industry, look for internship types of positions, because they will give you kind of a well-rounded view of maybe the company as a whole versus going into one type of area. So that's probably a route I would suggest.
I'm glad you brought up internships, Vicki, because we had our first question from the audience, and this question comes in from Salt Lake City. And the question is, how does someone get an internship? We know that they're valuable, but how do you go about getting one?
I think, you know, you have to look at companies and see where they're offering internships. I think some of the bigger firms, especially my employer, they have a variety of programs. One is kind of a credit risk kind of training program that a lot of recent graduates are a part of. We also have what we call CDPers, which are kind of college, it's a college development program where we actually go out and we recruit students from various colleges and have them work in an internship for a year and then usually transition them over to a full-time position. So I think you just have to get out there and look. I think there are a lot of internship opportunities, especially in the financial industry, and that is not just in banking. You know, financial industry is very huge. I mean, there's finance people everywhere, in hospitals, HR, as well as law firms, you know, those type of places you want to probably look into.
Vicki makes a good point. Internships can be found. You have to go find them. Obviously, you can go to the traditional routes and look online for those. Go back to your university, use your university, use your network, use your professional affiliations, use your neighbor. Find out where they work and ask if they would consider having someone in as a co-op or a summer intern or even during the school year for credit. Mm-hmm. It's valuable life experiences through internships, and those can be found if you look for them in all industries.
Sure. Absolutely. Okay, well, we have another question for the audience. How many are interested in the healthcare field? If you could just chat yes into the chat box if you are interested in this field, and we'll share those results shortly. We also have another question from the audience, and this one is specific to Dr. Rodriguez. Yes. How do I, at age 47, with no experience, enter the field of healthcare management?
Well, I think it's whether you're 47 or 27, I think how you enter the field is going to be the same way. And that is, you can either do some volunteer work, start networking, get to know some people. You know, one of the resources that's often overlooked, I found with my students, is they'll graduate, they develop their resume, everything looks great, but they forget to give a copy of the resume to their own doctor. And their doctor is probably pretty knowledgeable about where some of the jobs are, or maybe is looking for someone to help out in their office in the record keeping department or something like that. So 47 doesn't mean much to me. And I don't think that that's criteria in terms of what I'm seeing with healthcare employment.
Great, thank you. Okay, so let's go ahead and turn the tables over to human resources and discuss a little bit about that industry. So what about human resource what do human resource specialists do, and why is the field changing so rapidly?
Great question. The field is changing rapidly because of what we spoke about before. There's a change in the economy. Your retirees are starting to move out, and there's going to be growth opportunity in your organizations, in every industry. Human resource specialists can, there's various jobs. Most importantly, recruiting, attracting and retaining talent. Mm. You can't run an organization without human capital, and that's critical. Mm-hmm. But inside an organization, there are many parts to human resources that support an organization. As we talk, training and development. Mm-hmm. As we talk, there are benefit roles inside them as well. Human resources runs human capital. We don't run machines, and we don't produce the widgets or the product, but we make sure that we handle life events. We manage the employees that come into the organization, and we manage them all the way to when they leave the organization. And even beyond that, sometimes we manage them in retirement as well.
Great. So we talked about some of the areas that human resources participate in, but what types of organizations need human resource specialists?
That's the sweet spot, Christy, is every organization. Manufacturing, service, hospitals have a human resource organization. Banking has a human resource organization. Retail has human resources. There's so much compliance around HR as well. We are required to give COBRA notification. We're required to give certain information when you're hired. You're required to have a leave of absence. We have vacation policies. Legal is involved in HR. So there is no industry that is exempt from HR. It's a great entryway into the field as any industry.
That's great. So with all of the opportunities that are out there for those interested in human resources, where do you feel like someone can start? Where is the good starting point if they're looking to dive into that field?
Great question. Recruiting is a great start. The only reason I say that is because you learn about the organization. When you're hiring for the organization, you're learning about the positions, the job descriptions, you're learning about people, you're learning about the culture of the organization. Sometimes in recruiting, you're also responsible for bringing someone on board, and then you can acclimate them to the company. You're kind of their first voice to the company and your first image to the company. So recruiting is a great start, but there's also specialist areas. So if you come from a finance background and you're going for a finance degree and you want to get into human resources, they need actuaries in order to produce the statistics for us. Finance is a great place for a compensation person because we manage base salary, executive salaries, bonus plans, sales compensation plans. Great background for finance as well. So I would say those are some really great entry points.
Great. So can you tell us a little bit about your story and how you got to where you are today?
That's quite a story. I've actually devoted my entire career to human resources. I have a bachelor's and a master's degree, an MBA with an HR concentration. I have worked for, as I mentioned before, manufacturing industries, service industries, private, public industries. And I have devoted my life to human capital because I'm pretty passionate about it. I have also been very fortunate to work for some great companies that have allowed me to experience all the pieces of HR, starting with recruiting, compensation, benefits, labor relations, training and development, succession planning, everything from the very tactical to the very strategic. I've hit it all and very happy, and it's the education is extremely, extremely helpful to me.
Great. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay, so the results are in from our last question, and we have a really high number of our audience that is interested in healthcare management, 69%. So we have a lot out there interested, which is really great to hear. So let's talk to Vicky just for a little bit and talk about finance. So what do you think is the driving growth within your industry?
I think, you know, we talked about it a little bit earlier. I think the changes in the industry, the regulations, compliance issues, I think that has caused a big stir. More recently, a lot of banks have been in the news because of regulatory issues. So I do think that they're looking for more people to come on board to help with auditing, to make sure financial reporting is done correctly, those sort of things. And then I think, you know, to what some of my panel said, you know, finance is everywhere. I worked in HR and executive compensation. That's part of finance. We actually have a wellness team on staff. So there's healthcare right on board inside of a bank. So I think that, you know, people are looking on how to save money. They're looking on how to grow their income. So those jobs for financial advisors and analysts, those jobs are going to really grow as well in the future.
So what type of organizations need financial professionals? You talked about it a little bit, yes. But are there any others that we didn't cover?
I think everyone needs finance people. You can't operate without cash. So I think it goes across the board. It's just like HR. You know, you have to have people who are monitoring the books. You have to have accountants. You need people who are doing auditing. You need analysts, you need people who can approve credit, underwriting. All of that is finance. So I think it's across the board.
We have a lot of compliance in HR.
Yes.
I said it before, but we need finance people. You have all your pension plans and your 401k plans,
yes.
And they have to be audited every year, and you have to do compliance, and you have to do mailings. And I couldn't pass all those tests if it weren't for finance professionals that support human resources.
Yep.
Yeah. So we have another question in from the audience, and this one is for you, Kate. So how important is it to obtain a PHR certification?
Excellent question. There's PHR is a professional in human resources, and there's a lot of certifications actually for HR professionals. There's a certification for compensation professionals. Mm-hmm. There's certification for benefit professionals. Really important, because it's saying that you took the time to advance your degrees and your current education to say that I want to specialize in human resources. And it gives you that extra edge when you go to employment. It gives you that extra knowledge base for your current employer. I think they're very important. And quite frankly, those tests are not easy to pass. So congratulations to those that have and are going for that right now. Those are not easy.
Bob, Vicki, are there any certifications in your respective industries that you feel are important?
Well, again, I mentioned ACHE a little while ago, and I think that that's something that everyone interested in healthcare should at least look into. And it's easy to do, ACHE.org, and you can poke all around. But you'll see when you do that, the positions that involve finance, that involve HR, and you'll see where jobs are posted, where you can put a resume together, and so forth. So in many respects, I think that's a great place for any of our 69% interested population to get started, is to just look at that organization. Now, if they're particularly interested in something else, like epidemiology, one of my areas, there are societies for that. And of course, you know, some of them will certify, others just accept you as a member.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
But nonetheless, it shows your engagement.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And that's important.
Yeah, so I can't say enough about, you know, involvement. If you don't have certifications, at least get involved in your professional affiliation.
Right.
There are so many associations, it just takes a couple of meetings a year. Once a month, you go to a breakfast briefing or a lunch, and you network with professionals. I know in human resources, you find other professions and other industries when you go there. On top of your education, devote yourself to your education first, absolutely. But don't forget that professional affiliation out there. Really important.
I agree. I think in finance, especially if you're interested in becoming a financial advisor, there are many certifications you can get. A lot of, in the securities industry alone, you have to have, you know, your Series 7, your Series 6, your Series 66, if you want to sell securities. Those, again, are very difficult tests. I actually had a Series 7 at one point, so it's a very difficult test, but it gives you that extra little boost. There's also, you can become a certified financial analyst, which is a CFA. If you want to become like a CFO of a company, mm-hmm. it's very important that you have a lot of these different certifications, as well as, you know, like the panel said, get involved with some associations. There's an Association of Financial Professionals. So I think there's a lot that students or graduates can do to advance, not just have an advanced degree, but to go that one step further.
So outside of certifications, Vicki, what type of education do financial professionals need?
I would say definitely at a minimum a bachelor's degree in either business administration, finance, or accounting. And the reason why I say business administration is because I think that covers a wide spectrum of finance and accounting. I think there's enough there to get a person started in a financial industry, and then they can kind of figure out what avenue they want to take. Do I want to become like the financial analyst? Do I want to be an auditor? Do I want to be an accountant? Do I want to work in credit? And then from there, if they decide to go on, they can get an advanced degree in a more specialized field. Whether that's, you know, I kind of did the dual major accounting and finance. They could go straight finance. So I think there's, at a minimum, I would say bachelor's degree for sure.
Great. Thank you. So I'm going to ask the audience if they have any last questions. Please go ahead and chat those into the chat box. And I just want to say thank you all. You know, I feel like we had a really great discussion today, and I think we learned quite a bit about human resources, healthcare, and finance, and how these industries are growing and what type of job opportunities are out there for those interested in those various industries. So I just want to say thank you all for joining us today. You guys certainly are experts.
Thank you.
I'm very excited to have you here today. Yes, can't forget to thank AIU.
That's right.
And I also want to thank all of our audience here today for participating and asking questions. You were really a great part of this conversation and discussion as well. So one last thing for our audience. At the bottom of the chat screen, there is a survey link. And we just ask that you just take a moment to please provide us with feedback, and we really appreciate it. And also, thank you just for attending this webinar today. We're very excited to have you here as well as our panelists. And if you haven't had the opportunity yet, you know, I really recommend looking at AIU Serious Talk YouTube channel and looking and taking a sneak peek at all of the previous webinars that we've held in the past. There's some really great information there for you to take a look at as well. So thanks again to our panelists. Thank you to our audience. And everyone have a great afternoon.